All right, today is Wednesday, April 7th, and this is a recap for the stock market activities today. Once again, we are in the calm before the storm period, meaning that we are about to see a very large move taking place in the stock market, and that move could be up or down. And our job in this video and every day is to look at the facts, study the charts and every other indicator, and come up with a rational conclusion. So we will do that. In addition, I'm going to talk about the upcoming wage inflation because I have more data for you. And I will link the wage inflation with the possibility of a future stagflation in the economy. I also want to talk about the Federal Reserve discontinuing updating the money supply data. Is there a sinister reason behind that? Are they trying to hide something here? Furthermore, I want to talk about the MMT, the modern monetary theory. And is the federal government and the Federal Reserve already practicing MMT? Furthermore, I want to talk about the remedy if inflation shoots above the Fed's target, because they keep saying we're not adapting any formula. We're just going to eyeball inflation and average it at 2%. What if inflation shoots up above the Fed's target? What are the so-called tools that the Federal Reserve will use? And I also want to cover the letter from JP Morgan CEO Jamie Dimon. You know, Jamie Dimon is the Grand Ayatollah of Wall Street. And today, all over Wall Street and CNBC, they had a massive orgasm. Oh, Jamie Dimon said something. So we will cover that and a lot more. And here we go. The Dow Industrial Average closing in the green by 16.02 points, or a gain of 0.05%. The NASDAQ closing in the red, down 9.54 points, or a decline of 0.07%. The S&P 500 closing in the green by 6.01 points, or a gain of 0.15%. And what about the sector's performance? Leading the pack at number one and capturing the gold medal, communication services, at number two for the silver, energy, and at number three for the bronze, technology. Meanwhile, the laggards of the day, led by consumer cyclicals, healthcare, and industrials. Once again, we are not creating any specific themes in the market. It's a wishy-washy, jittery kind of trading, one day pumping one sector of the market and the next day dumping it right away. And therefore, we're saying you cannot extract any valuable information or base any investment decisions from the trading action that started last week and going throughout this week as well. Moving on to the futures market performance, starting with crude oil. Both the WTI and the Brent closed with modest gains of about half a percentage point or so. What about softs? Big gains for lumber. We also saw gains for cotton. Meanwhile, losses for OJ, about 1% or so, but the action was muted for the rest of softs futures. Coca, coffee, sugar, pretty much flat for the day. What about metals? Muted activities for gold, silver, but losses led by palladium, copper, and platinum. The US dollar is stable today. It paused the declines, and right away you are seeing a negative reaction in metals. What about meats? Here we go. Lean hogs, aka the new tech, surging higher once again. We also saw decent gains for both live and feeder cattle. What about grains? The gainers led by canola, corn, and soybean meal futures. We saw noticeable declines for soybean oil futures. It was the leader of last session. Today it is the loser. We also saw losses for soybeans and oats futures. Meanwhile, rough rice and wheat futures muted for the day. Moving on to the big casino, the options market, and let's see what's going on here. But before we start, we talked last night about the pump in the Chinese stocks, specifically the ones involved in the Archegos Capital blow-up, in addition to the mania names, the mania stocks, also catching a bid yesterday due to a mini gamma squeeze in the options market. And here is a report from Bloomberg explaining more.
Yeah, we all know about the Archegos saga by now. It's been interesting to watch over the past week. Yesterday, we saw a notable uptick in near-term call buying in VIPS, GSX, and IQ, to name a few. No doubt these calls are expensive. Implied volatility levels are high, but it's just a unique situation where you have stocks that are down so much from the highs from just about a month ago. It is an interesting opportunity to look at long calls here, particularly if you think these stocks are ready to bounce. I mean, you can argue that much of the forced selling has either run its course or been announced to the market or been digested by the market. I would point out that the call buying that we saw in these names was very near term, all occurring within the April expiration, whether it was the April weeklies, April regular, or April 30th expiration. So much more of a trade looking for a near-term bounce as opposed to a, you know, longer-term investment in these stocks.
Yeah, fair enough, Chris. And we do actually have the VIPS call option and put volume chart. So a VIPS shop is a retail branded products discount that you get over the internet. And you can see that the amount of call volumes surging there, it's that yellow line as well as puts drop.
And by the way, keep in mind, this was a pump and dump because these names, VIPS shop, GSX, NEO, all down big today. So you gotta be careful here. Don't be seduced by the moves day to day, specifically from last week and this week, because you cannot take anything the market is doing seriously with this low volume and no movement in yields. You need a significant movement in yields one way or the other before we can make a solid conclusion. Anyhow, here's how the casino did today. Number one, Apple, with about 1.3 million contracts. About 68% of those were calls. At number two, a name that we don't see usually, AT&T, with about 800,000 contracts. About 91.5% of those were calls. Now, I noticed a theme here, or a reoccurrence. Every time I saw AT&T blasting higher in this list, with 80+% of the options traded were calls, the reaction of the stock the very next day was actually negative. So it will be interesting to see how AT&T will do tomorrow. But here we have a number three, SOS, with about 680,000 contracts. About 89.5% of those were calls. You gotta be careful here, because these Chinese names, in this case SOS, which is a crypto miner from China, but with a lot of scandals and a lot of short sellers, including Hindenburg, went against this company. Yesterday, VIPS shop popped higher with enormous call options volume. Today, SOS, what do you know, tomorrow they dump the name again. Gotta be very, very careful. What about the unusual trades that took place in the options market today? And you gotta pay attention here, because we have some sophisticated trades that took place in the options market today. Specifically, this trade for the SPY, the S&P 500, because somebody is making a bearish bet, but this trade has three legs. So it is a bit complicated, but it is easy to understand if you are paying attention. And this is the way I interpret the trade, by the way. The trader is buying the 355 puts on the SPY expiring May 14th. And they are expecting the SPY, the S&P 500, to decline between 10 to 15% correction. And they paid about 75 cents a piece to enter this trade for this particular leg. And they paid about $1.8 million. And then they sold the 335 puts, same expiration date, May 14th, and they collected about 40 cents apiece for this trade. All in all, they received about $1.9 million. So now they have an extra $100,000 from opening this trade. But here is the third leg. They also bought the 315 puts, expiration date, May 14th. They paid about 24 cents apiece to enter this trade. All in all, they paid $570,000 for this one. Now remember, the 355 leg, they paid $1.8 million. The 355 leg that they sold, they collected $1.9 million. And for the third leg, they paid about $570,000. All in all, the total entry price for this trade, the three legs included, is about $670,000. Now, what is this trader trying to achieve with this trade? Here is a visualization for you. If by expiration date, the SPY closes above 355, then the trader will suffer losses. In this case, they will lose the $670,000. That was the entry cost for the trade. But if the S&P 500 indeed goes down and suffers a correction of about 10 to 15% and trades below 355, then this trade will be profitable. Now, remember, they sold the 335 leg, meaning that if the SPY goes below 335, their gains will be capped and they will not be able to score any gains below 335. But remember, they sold double the quantity of the 355 leg, meaning that they will actually start suffering losses if the SPY VWY trades below 335, and therefore they open the 315 leg as insurance in case the SPY starts to collapse rapidly below 335. Then the 315 leg will start to appreciate, and that will balance things out, and the trade will be profitable. But this is not the ideal scenario, that the trade goes all the way to 315. The trader is betting on a 10 to about 15% correction, meaning the trader wants the SPY to close just a tiny bit above 335 by the expiration date. And in this case, they will triple their money. They will collect about $2 million in profits. But the important message is, what is this trader trying to send? What is the message? The message is, this is not insurance. This is a bearish bet against the SPY. This trader has the conviction that the S&P 500 will drop big by May 14th, but they are expecting about 10 to 15% correction. They're not expecting more. But if that happens and the S&P 500 collapses below 335, then they have the insurance policy of 315. That leg will start to appreciate. But here is why I say that this trade is done by a professional, because the management of the trade will become extremely critical. The management of the trade will make the difference whether this trade will be profitable or not. So I did like the structure and I did follow this trade. Moving on to the trade for the ticker IWM, the small cap ETF, lagging the market today, and it's been lagging for a while now. The weakness is becoming evident. So somebody's making a bearish bet by buying the 207 puts expiration date April 23rd, with expectations that the IWM will decline over 6% by then, and they paid about $1.20 apiece to enter this trade, bringing the total all the way to $1 million. What about the trade for the ticker LYFT? This is for Lyft, in case it wasn't evident. They're buying the 50 puts, so this is a bearish bet, and the expiration date is May 21st, with expectations that Lyft will drop over 18.5% by then, and they paid about 90 cents apiece to enter this trade, which brought the total all the way to about $700,000. Now, here is another spread for the ticker GRUB, Grubhub. They are making a bullish bet via a debit spread. They are buying the 75 calls expiration date May 21st, with expectations that Grubhub will gain over 15% by then. They paid about $2 apiece to enter this trade. And then they sold the 80 calls, same expiration date, May 21st, and they collected about $1.50 apiece. All in all, the total cost to enter this trade was $50 apiece, and that in turn made the total entry cost for this trade at about $250,000. Moving on to the headlines that shape the day, starting with macro news. Starting with the trade deficit. U.S. trade deficit hits record high as economy gains speed. Are they talking about speed as in economic growth, or are they talking about speed, as in the economy on drugs? You know, the artificial stimulation by the Federal Reserve and the federal government coming out of the printing machine. And speaking of the printing machine, it is causing a lot of inflation. What about housing inflation? Satisfy my daily dose of doom and gloom. Here it is. Pandemic migration made rent less affordable across the United States. So all of this moving out of California and other places is spreading the yayo around, and prices are increasing across the board. You thought we had a homeless problem before? Watch what's going to happen now. Here is your dose of doom and gloom. Total collapse in the housing market. But I'm not kidding about inflation rising higher across this economy. The Federal Reserve says, where is inflation? We can't see inflation. We can't even smell inflation. We can't even hear inflation. The CPI says it's at about 1.5%. And the Federal Reserve says the goal is 2% average, meaning that they are willing to tolerate inflation to rise above 2% from the CPI. Now, if 1.5% on the CPI causing all of these shortages, an explosion in commodity prices and the cost of living, can you imagine what 3% would do? How about oil at $100? How about lumber at $1,500? Perhaps then the Federal Reserve will start to see inflation. But here it is, freight costs, shipping costs, through the roof. Look at the difference between 2021, the current year that we're in right now, in case you haven't noticed, and between 2020 and 2019. We are way, way higher, and we are trending higher and higher by the day. Unbelievable. But where is inflation? Where is it? I can't see it. Where is inflation? But perhaps all of you inflation deniers will submit and believe inflation right away, instantly, and demand that the Federal Reserve does something immediately, this moment. You know why? Because prices of bacon are rising higher, exploding higher. Matter of fact, we can tolerate housing inflation. We can tolerate automobile inflation, lumber, oil, bellies. We can tolerate all of that, but don't you dare inflate our bacon. The cost of bacon has ticked higher during the pandemic as hog prices climb, aka the new tech bro, and Americans' demand stays elevated. Costco, in its quarterly earnings call last month, said that the price per pound it pays suppliers for bacon had risen 45%. 45%, prompting analysts to joke about making a run to one of its warehouses. Quote unquote, pork is in a runway. The price has skyrocketed, said Arrowstream lead economist Isaac Olevra, who predicts tight supply through the summer for processed items, including sausage, hot dogs, and bacon. How dare you? What are we gonna eat now? By the way, sausage, hot dogs, hamburgers, bacon, and cheese. So next summer when you do your backyard barbecue, we're gonna start charging for those hot dogs. No more free hot dogs. And what about wage inflation? Because the Federal Reserve will tolerate every single shape and shade of inflation. But when it comes to wage inflation, God forbid, your wages start to go higher, we got to end the party. And here's what's going to lead to higher wages, which is good news for us, right? Not good news for Wall Street, though. Job openings reached all-time highs, surpassing the pre-pandemic highs. There were so many jobs coming out of our ears, our eyes, our noses, our wherever. Jobs. Here comes jobs. No black turtleneck sweater. The real jobs. They're all over the place. But the problem is they cannot fill them because employers are struggling to find quote-unquote qualified workers, qualified employees, and therefore they have to offer more incentives, sign-up bonuses, a new car, a happy meal, whatever. And that's not working. So they are hiking the wages in their office because you gotta attract qualified workers. With the tsunami of liquidity, the pent-up demand, the savings rate through the roof, we have an upcoming orgy of slurping in the economy, buying everything, vacations all over the place. And businesses are scrambling to find employees. Why do I need a job when I'm making money with my diamond hands on Robinhood? Why do I need a job when my diamond ass is producing enough income from OnlyFans? What about the gig economy, my Etsy store, etc., etc.? What about my Stimmy? What about my free cash? Leading to wage hikes in the new offers and even with existing employees. They don't want them to go somewhere else, and therefore they're hiking wages even for current employees. So this is a problem for employers. Wage inflation, in addition to minimum wage, and by the way, the minimum wage opponents will say, oh, if you hike the minimum wage, everything is going to be robots and automation. That's going to happen anyways. So we might as well increase the minimum wage and milk these assholes before they replace us with robots anyways. But here it is. Wait for it. You want to see talent? You want to see how I connect everything together? You want to see some magic? We just talked about wage inflation. Now we're talking about automation. We're going to take all that together and talk about inflation. So watch it. Here it is. Marriott Hotels test replacing desk clerks with automated kiosks. McDonald's is doing the same thing. Automation, robots all over the place. This will be the future. We're going to have inflation from all of the tsunami of liquidity and money supply, which we can't get updates on anymore. We'll talk about that in a little bit. But we're also going to start losing jobs, and the unemployment rate will remain higher, and it will stick there because of automation. The economy is hot, 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 inflation all over the place. But the problem is, it is also accompanied with a persistent high unemployment rate. This is a recipe for stagflation, and this is what the Federal Reserve is totally ignoring. They don't even believe inflation to worry about stagflation. But this is how stagflation could happen easily and very fast. While corporate America is on fire from all the stimmies, the bailouts, the donkey money from the Robin Hoodiots and the likes, pushed the financials of corporate America to be at its best shape ever. But when it comes to Main Street, small business, mom and pops, they are still in a massive depression, not recession, depression. 42% of small business owners in struggling industries don't expect a full recovery until 2022 or later. We're talking about event management, travel, entertainment, photography, therapist, yoga. You get the list. You can read it. I don't have to read it for you. Small business, they're not having the orgasm, the orgy that's going on in Wall Street. And you know that the heart and the backbone for this economy and this country is small business, mom and pops. But you think these bastards in the government give a rat's ass about mom and pops? Or do they work for Wall Street and corporate America? That's the reality, isn't it? You got your dose of doom and gloom. Now, let me give you your dose of reality. And here's what's happening from this whole grand experiment, the quote-unquote greatest experiment in financial history, courtesy of the Federal Reserve. These mad scientists, for the first time since the 1990s, the global middle class shrank last year, not just in the U.S., but globally, from the cabal of central banks' policies, make the rich richer and the poor poorer, and as a result, the middle class disappears completely. And all of this mania from central banks, in this case the Federal Reserve, is causing a ton of inflation, but not real gains or expansion of the economy. Cocaine-free expansion. And therefore the market, specifically the bonds market, is calling the bluff of the Federal Reserve. Future traders are pricing in a Fed rate hike by the end of 2020, with three additional rate increases penciled in by early 2024. That contrasts with the Fed officials have recently signaled, which is for rates to stay near zero until at least 2024. And this leads us to the dilemma. What are the quote-unquote tools? You know, when the Federal Reserve talks about not talking, about talking, about thinking, about thinking, about thinking, about thinking about raising interest rates. And then when they talk about inflation, they say it is transitory. And if it is not transitory, then we got the tools, bro. So what are the tools? Assuming that inflation will rise over 3%. Because remember, the Federal Reserve will eyeball things. No formula whatsoever. These mad scientists. What are the remedies to combat inflation? Number one, raising interest rates. The problem is the Federal Reserve will not be able to raise interest rates because raising interest rates will create an economic crash that exceeds the crash of 2008. The market will completely explode, losing 30, 40, maybe 50% of its current value. And the reason is we do have a zombified economy with zombie companies and zombie government. If you raise the interest rate, you're going to see explosions all over the place. Companies blowing up like Archegos Capital because they will default on their interest payments. So what is the other remedy? The Volcker way, which is tackling the money supply. Not just cutting the cocaine operation of bond purchasing, but cutting the money supply entirely. And Wall Street will not like that at all. Once again, the cure is worse than the illness. If you hike interest rates, you will nuke the economy. If you cut the money supply, then the problem is the government will not be able to satisfy its obligations. And taxes will go to 90% because where else will the government secure the funding for all of this spending? Meaning that the money supply is not an option. The money supply will continue to explode higher and higher and higher. So are they really thinking about raising interest rates as a remedy for inflation? Because that would be a nuclear explosion in the economy. What a bunch of Looney Tunes. But perhaps the Federal Reserve has another tool, another option, and that option is deception. Lie, deceive, distort. And perhaps, cross your finger, and perhaps the problem will just disappear. Perhaps inflation will just get scared away. And this is what they're doing. Propaganda and censoring of information, hiding the truth, as if this was North Korea. As inflation looms, the Fed discontinues key data. First, they stop updating the velocity of money, which is the most important measure for inflation right now. We have all of this money supply, but inflation officially is not showing up because the money supply remains depressed. Now, if the money supply starts to rise again, we will know right away and how fast to call the Fed's bluff. So the Federal Reserve decided to just censor the information rather than addressing the problem honestly. And by hiding the information, they're hoping that inflation expectations will get tampered if you censor the facts and leave us in the dark. Conspiracy theorists, they call us conspiracy theorists. Anybody who questions the bullshit is a conspiracy theorist. Anyways, they might wonder why the Fed made the decision right as inflation seems ready to rise. Rational economists might wonder why the data would disappear when it's most needed. The Fed does discontinue data at times. However, the timing of this decision does leave much to be desired. We can use other data series to find similar information, but we will never know why the Fed decided to hide the original data from the public. And here is what they did next, discontinuing updating the money supply entirely. So now we are totally in the dark. We don't have a dashboard anymore. And the Federal Reserve is hoping that we will just forget about inflation and inflation expectations will get tampered down. How the hell is this happening in this country? No freedom of information. And here it is. Deny, deny, and do more and more propaganda. Chicago Fed Evans only need to be concerned if there is a bothersome inflation. 2.5% inflation should not be viewed as out of bounds. Now, if we are at 1.5% already, and we have all of this inflation in input costs, a chip shortage, industries about to get blown from the severe inflation at 1.5%. If this madman says 2.5%, then what will happen to the problem that we are already having? It's already hurting companies, businesses, and the consumer. And perhaps the Federal Reserve is hiding the money supply data because money supply will continue to explode higher and higher and higher. There is no other choice. How are we gonna finance all of these budget deficits and all of the trillions and trillions of dollars that were already spent and about to be spent? You're gonna have to keep the printing machine going on and on and on to infinity and beyond. Buzz Lightyear. But perhaps the Federal Reserve and the Biden administration are adapting MMT, modern monetary theory, which says that debt doesn't matter because you can print money to infinity and beyond and you can finance everything. And there is no consequences to printing an infinite amount of money. There are no ramifications to racking up an insane amount of debt. Perhaps the Federal Reserve is now believing in MMT that they're going to spend to fix society's problems, from racial inequity to climate change, wildfires, shark attacks, and they're going to rack up an insane number of money supply. And therefore, they are censoring the data because they're trying to tamper inflation expectations. And that begs the question, and I'm talking to the deflationary crowd, by the way, who continue to deny and deny and deny inflation. They say, yes, commodity prices are going higher, and yes, yields are going higher, but gold is not going higher, and therefore the risk is actually deflationary. Genius. The correlation between gold and the 10-year yield is inverse, meaning that when inflation goes higher, or inflation expectations in this case, gold actually goes lower. So this is the gold myth, that it is a hedge against inflation. It might not be this time around. In the 70s, we had the dollar decline. The conditions of the 70s might not be replicated this time around. Be careful. But the question is, for the deflationary crowd, if you believe that the money supply doesn't cause inflation, there is no monetary inflation, then perhaps you are a believer in MMT, right? Oh, hell no. No MMT. I don't believe in MMT. And hacking the minimum wage will increase inflation. But money supply increasing, oh, that doesn't cause inflation. Wow. These people are hypocrites. That's what it is, really. Because if you are in the deflationary crowd. You must believe in MMT. Money supply doesn't matter. Then let's just give everybody free healthcare, education, cars, shoes, houses. Doesn't matter. No taxes. Unbelievable. And the Biden administration and Jerome Powell of the Federal Reserve haven't spoken since Biden took office. Oh, really? Are we a bunch of morons to believe this? This is happening in synchrony. They are turning the role of the Federal Reserve to fulfill MMT, Modern Monetary Theory. But let's see what the Dallas Fed has to say, specifically from President Kaplan. You know Kaplan, we talked about him before many times in this program, with his famous $20,000 leather chair. Oh, he loves that chair. And he sits on that chair and he talks about the plight of the poor and the agony of the unemployed sitting on his $20,000 chair. Yet the thing with Kaplan is that sometimes he slips and he says things he's not supposed to say. For example, Kaplan says he does not think it would be healthy for markets to think part of the Fed's mission is to monetize growth in government debt. But isn't this what they're doing already? This is what the Federal Reserve is doing right now. It's not about us thinking, or it's not healthy to think that it's happening. It's already happening. So we have Kaplan channeling his inner comic. Fed's Kaplan would prefer substantially taper asset purchases before adjusting rates, but wants to maintain flexibility. This is the same dilemma we just talked about. The cure is worse than the illness. What do you do if inflation persists? You're going to cut interest rates, or are you going to cut the cocaine? Both will crash the economy and the stock market. Kaplan says, I prefer cutting the cocaine first before cutting interest, increasing interest rates, because increasing interest rates will blow up this zombie economy. And let's circle back to Chicago Fed Evans, the genius that he is. Size of fiscal packages mean Fed can ultimately do less. So what are you saying here, Mr. Evans? Because fiscal packages come from the Fed doing something, aka the printing machine. So if fiscal packages will allow the Federal Reserve to do less, then how will the government finance those fiscal packages? Are you saying higher taxes? Here it is. Biden willing to negotiate on corporate tax rate, but says inaction, not an option on infrastructure. They're coming for higher taxes. Corporate, rich, middle, poor, doesn't matter. Taxes have to go higher because the Federal Reserve will not be able to maintain the cocaine operation. At some point, the federal government has to stand on its feet, and its feet means revenue. The largest source of revenue for the U.S. government is taxes. Here comes Cuomo. Even your state and local taxes are going higher. New York government Cuomo says the state's taxes will be lower, even with recently proposed tax hikes. Does that even make sense? Like, how stupid do you have to be to believe this garbage? Yeah, we hacked tax rates, but they're actually going lower. And the reason is because the cap on salt deductions will be repealed. Now, does Cuomo know something we don't know? Because for now, the Biden administration is saying we're keeping the cap on salt deductions. They gotta raise taxes. There is no other way. This country will get destroyed and they have to raise taxes substantially. And here it is. Even Jeff Bezos, the evil emperor himself, is now supporting higher taxes. And we know that Mr. Bezos is cozy with the Biden administration. I mean, if you're going to let the guy French kiss your wife, you might be cozy with him. At least. And Mr. Bezos, of course, cares not about increasing taxes now. He already destroyed every mom and pop business out there while he was making zero profits. But the monetary policy and the fiscal policy allowed Amazon, the cancer that it is, to grow in the body of the economy. And Mr. Bezos dumped about $20 billion worth of Amazon stock. He has $20 billion in liquid cash. What does he care? He's now at the billionaire stage of let me play woke. I think he already passed the space asshole stage. You know, when you become a billionaire, a few years later, your interest in rockets starts to rocket. And now he wants to play Mr. Woke, Mr. Clean, and pretends that he cares. Such a humanitarian, right after he finished looting. We have another one with Jamie Dimon. We'll talk about him in details in a little bit, but he's also supporting higher taxes now. Meanwhile, his salary last year is about $31.5 million. They already hit the jackpot, and now they don't mind increasing taxes. And speaking of Mr. Jamie Dimon, you know Wall Street's sweetheart? Oh, they love this guy. When CNBC does an interview with him, they talk about that particular interview all day. Oh my God, my interview with JB Diamond. Did you see his hair? Oh my God, his hair. Oh, his tan. Did you see his tan? They worship this guy, and every word that comes out of his mouth is pure gold. And the reason is, he is the biggest gangster on Wall Street. You know, he pretends to care. He takes a knee, pretending that he cares about black people. Meanwhile, during the financial crisis, the housing crisis of 08 and 09, his bank was foreclosing homes of black people and kicking them out of their homes. But today, Jamie Dimon released his annual letter, and he says the U.S. economy will continue to boom all the way to 2023. And then he issued some woke stuff just to give us the illusion that he cares. Jamie Dimon slams state and local tax repeal as a benefit to the rich. JP Morgan CEO blasts tax breaks for race cars and private jets and says the write-offs need to stop after he already did write off his own race cars and private jets. Now he wants to shut down the party. And as you continue to read the letter, Jamie Dimon becomes even more woke. Jamie Dimon says COVID-19 pandemic and the murder of George Floyd in the past year have exposed the devastating effects, long-standing and profound, inequities. What do you think? And then he issued statements regarding the banking industry. Banks have enormous competitive threats from virtually every angle. Fintech and big tech are here. Big time, Jamie Dimon said. And right away you saw the stock of Square surging higher today on the Cash App optimism. Of course, everybody's watching what Jamie Dimon of Chase Bank will acquire next, because he sees the threat and he will do a lot of acquisitions in the future. So now the speculation game begins. Which small fintech company JP Morgan will buy next? I don't know, you tell me. Give me tickers or give me death. But you know Jamie Dimon of JP Morgan, aka the Laundromat. The man is a gangster. He's a thug. And we call it the Laundromat because he got caught washing money for drug cartels, criminals, mobsters, thugs. And I'm not making this up. Here it is. JP Morgan and Deutsche Bank named in money laundering report. They've been laundering money for gangsters. And JP Morgan is the biggest criminal organization in America. It's the most sophisticated criminal organization. Al Capone would be jealous. JP Morgan staff said a $1.1 billion deal might be corrupt. The bank sent money anyway before a mammoth oil deal turned into an international scandal. High-level managers inside one of the world's biggest bank knew of serious risk. And as you might be aware, they already robbed the PPP loans program, and they got caught manipulating the commodities market, specifically gold and silver. To the tune of, the U.S. government called JP Morgan commodities desk a crime ring. A crime ring. The U.S. says precious metals desk at JP Morgan was a racketeering operation. This is like Gambino and Luciano. This is the mafia, racketeering. Now the bank is poised to pay a record penalty for spoofing. Here's a look behind 8 years. Is this a bank or a criminal organization? But the problem is that criminal organizations are highly profitable. So you gotta invest in these criminal organizations. Crime pays. What are you going to invest in? An honest company that reports real numbers? Good luck. And I know you might be asking yourself, where is the SEC? Why didn't the SEC do anything? Well, the SEC is a dormant organization in a coma. Scams all over the place. It is the golden age of fraud. Just take a look at Reverend Elon Musk manipulations. But the SEC are starting to wake up. And they are flexing their muscles, not on the actual market manipulators, but they're just trying to look for scapegoats. And now they're coming after the big short, Michael Burry, forcing him to quit Twitter because he will be under an SEC investigation. And they are flexing their muscles on small shots, small-time criminals. US SEC charges actor with operating a $690 million Ponzi scheme. Once again, ladies and gentlemen, I made a video a few months ago calling this the golden age of fraud. Money all over the place, tsunami of liquidity, and scams all over the place. Who is this actor? Zachary Horowitz. And Horowitz is a horrible person because he ran a scam claiming to investors that the money will be used to buy the rights for films that HBO and Netflix signed to distribute specifically in Latin America. And the question is, would you trust this guy with anything beside holding this beer? But again, It is the golden age of fraud. Speaking of, let's talk about the Archegos capital and the blow up that took place a few days ago. We know that Goldman Sachs and Morgan Stanley now got out unscathed, but Credit Suisse and other banks continue to suffer losses. And every day we get more details. It is even more mind-blowing. It is still incredible to me that Credit Suisse is taking a $4.7 billion write-off when their entire prime brokerage business is estimated to only generate $1 billion in revenue. So what is the remedy? Regulators will react to the Archegos fiasco by fining companies involved, changing rules for family offices above a to-be-determined size and prime brokerages, requiring higher capital levels against counterparties in derivatives trades. Of course, this is a wishful thinking because it will never happen. The crooks already paid the prostitutes in Washington, D.C. to allow them to run the scam and exclude family offices from reporting their trades and filing anything with the SEC. More in market sentiment. What about the tulip mania of the 21st century? You know, they keep saying it's a $2 trillion market, the crypto market, the future, bro, yada, yada. It's not going to be in China. China has its own digital currency. It's not going to be in India. And now perhaps it's not going to be in Singapore because they're warning the public about the risk of creating cryptocurrencies as the world warms up to Bitcoin. But rest assured, I got you back, and I have some good crypto news. CoinDesk says revenue reached $1.8 billion, while net income will hit between $730 million to $800 million for this quarter. And remember, the IPO for Coinbase is just a few days away. This will be the ultimate test to the absence of retail traders. If this thing bombs, then the retail trader is dead indeed. But if we see this name exploding higher, then the retail trader is perhaps still here, but perhaps they're holding a lot of bags. The diamond hands might shatter. And speaking of diamond hands, you know the retail crowd loves these speculative names, blink charging, fuel cell, plug power, yada yada. But the problem is they haven't learned from the dot-com bubble when we saw the mania names crashing and never recovering the highs. And now even Jim Cramer, the king of propaganda, the perma-bull, is warning that we might not see the highs for these names for years to come. Perhaps never.
Yeah, because, I mean, what happened is that there was that article this morning was so seminal, actually, because it was the numbers are staggering. The decline in Robinhood, which is coming public, the decline of traffic, the decline of people looking at it. It's almost as if, yes, it finally happened again, like in 20, you know, you're going back to 2001, they just put their statements in the drawer and said, don't worry, the companies are going to come back. Carl, the companies don't come back for the vast majority that we learned, they don't come back. And that's why if you're diversified, you're going to survive this period. I mean, remember, the S&P was up 7% in the first quarter, and yet there are people putting their statements in their drawer, not wanting to look at it. What did they own? And the answer is, I think they owned a lot of stuff that they bought very high. And yes, it is true, Snowflake is a great company, and ARK Innovation is a great fund, and we see some terrific SPACs. But that doesn't mean that their stock prices where they were bought are anywhere near here. And I think a lot of people are foolish if they think that stocks just come back. You have to work at it. I mean, you have to make, I wish we hadn't called them value stocks, but it was too boring to buy Caterpillar and buy Nucor. Carl, they wanted Flash. They wanted Fisker. They wanted Nikola. They wanted a lot of things that are charging stations. And Carl, they may not come back as fast as people think, if at all.
Even Jim Cramer is saying this. But is the market listening at all? Of course not. Specifically when we talk about clown Dan Ivis. In our opinion, tech stocks have an upward 25 to 30% move higher. You know, because it's a super thank you. More in market sentiment. We talked about Penn National Gaming declining severely the last few days. And now we know why. There is a leaked sex tape from Davey Barstool. Cry baby Barstool. Who cares? Moving on to Tom Brady, who's trying to milk the mania. We know that Tom Brady is a cheat. He deflates the ball, and he's going to cut corners, creating scams all over the place to milk this mania for all of its worth. Tom Brady is launching an NFT platform called Autograph that will bring together some of the biggest names in sport, entertainment, fashion, and pop culture to work with creators to develop unique digital Collectibles. A representative for Brady says, and if that gig doesn't work and Brady ends up losing money, rest assured he will rob the taxpayer the same way he robbed the PPP loan program. And here's the last bit of sentiment news from Norway, the largest sovereign wealth fund. You know, I've been talking about this lazy era of ETF investing and pick a stock out of a hat, a technology stock, and you get to make money. This insane bull market where everybody's a genius. Now, even Norway, the wealth fund agrees with me that the lazy era is over. And now you got to do the work because they're advocating for more active management and stock picking. Indeed, this is a stock picking market. And those YouTubers who looked like geniuses the last few years, all of a sudden, they're scrambling all over the place. What's going on? What's going on? A difficult market. Not everybody's a genius. You got to actually do the work. And now we're losing a lot of money. So I have to produce more content on YouTube, dumping 5 videos a day, jamming 100 ads in each to compensate for their gambling losses. Because the stocks they've been advocating for, the Teslas, the Plug Powers, the CCIV, all of this garbage is down in certain cases over 50% from the highs. Have you noticed the frequency of YouTube videos once the market started to dive lower? Moving on to corporate specific news, starting with Pinterest. Pinterest is launching a creator fund to pay influencers, specifically from underrepresented backgrounds. My question is, how come YouTube is not paying content creators from underrepresented backgrounds? You know, financial YouTubers who speak the truth, we are underrepresented. So I demand to get paid more from YouTube. What about the souffle? Bad news for the souffle. Tesla delays deliveries of new Model S and Model X. And the reason is the stunning demand that the Tesla bros and Elon culties keep reminding me of every single day. And lastly, what about Uber? Uber announces $250 million stimulus to bring back drivers. Drivers don't want to come back because they're making more money gambling on Robinhood. But perhaps after the market crashes, Uber doesn't have to incentivize them anymore. Moving on to the heat map analysis. Can we extract anything, any theme from today's activities? Of course not. You cannot take the action seriously. Yesterday, the mania names and the Chinese names popped higher. Today, they're collapsing again. And big tech is actually gaining momentum once again. So you gotta stick with your current strategy, whatever that is. For me, for example, concentrating on the inflationary trade of financials, energy, industrials, materials, and defensives. If you stuck to your own strategy, instead of hopping over like a grasshopper, chasing the action, you're doing fine. But if you chase the mania names yesterday, today you're suffering. Stop chasing the action. Stick to the strategy. There is a big move coming. We don't know where, which direction, but it is coming. So hopping back and forth from one section of the market to the other is not healthy. We don't have a theme today. Moving on to the charts analysis, starting with the SPY 30 minutes chart. What do we see here? Anything going on? Absolutely nothing. Trading flat. Yes, we do have gaps, but we are trading at all-time highs. We are in a bullish consolidation. There is an energy buildup, which is supposed to be released to the upside. But if for whatever reason that doesn't happen, the energy will be released to the downside. So we have to watch yields. We have to watch what's going on in the macro environment, the news, because there is a big move imminent. This consolidation will build up a lot of energy, and that energy will be released. The technicals for now are saying to the upside. But the problem is you cannot make a definitive conclusion one way or the other because the volume is very low. And here it is, I'm highlighting that to you. The volume is indeed lower than average. So there is no conviction or confirmation to any of the action we saw since last week. What about the continuous contract of the S&P 500? Well above 3,960, consolidating in a bull flag formation, which is supposed to play to the upside. Is there a risk to the downside? Yes, there is. We talked about the weekly chart of the cash index, the rising wedge. What about the Qs, the 15 minutes chart? Similar story here. No action today, consolidating in a bull flag consolidation, in a bullish consolidation, which is supposed to play to the upside. But all of that energy that's been built up for a few days now will be released. And for whatever reason, if it's not released to the upside, it will be released to the downside with the same ferocity. And if that is the case, you have the gaps to look forward to. What will trigger a release to the energy downward? Perhaps a rise, a shoot up in treasury yields. But absent of that, the move is expected to break to the upside, at least from a technical perspective. And here is the daily chart for the continuous contract. What do we see here? As I told you, the level of 13,599 will remain sticky, and it will act as tough resistance. Now, so far, we caught support from the purple trend line. We bounced higher. We closed slightly above 13,599. We are consolidating in a bull flag formation that is supposed to break to the upside. The confirmation for this one is to watch treasury yields. The confirmation for the SPY is to watch the VIX. If we see a breakdown in treasury yields, then the NASDAQ will boost higher. If we see a breakdown in the VIX, the SPY will go higher. So sometimes when you look at the chart, say the SPY, and it doesn't tell you anything, can the VIX chart tell you something that you're not seeing in the SPY's chart? What about the IWM? Weaker than the NASDAQ and the SPY. Closing in the red today, yet not closing the gap at 218. So we are waiting to see if the chart will close the 218 gap. When we zoom out to the daily chart of the RUT, the Russell 2000, it is starting to look concerning here because I gave you the number of 2,264 as the line in the sand. Closing above that line from a weekly chart perspective will take the bear flag out of the window, and we will make a higher high in the IWM. If that doesn't happen, however, then the chart will break the bullish trend and the negative divergence in the RSI will indeed play out. What about the dollar index? We have a mini bounce today, but we are expecting the dollar index to continue to go all the way to 92 to capture support. You get a capture support from 92 and then bounce higher, creating a higher low and continuing the bullish series. Now, breaking the pattern by creating a lower high or lower low will be a bearish signal and a shorting signal. What about gold? Gold had the opportunity to pop higher today, and it chose not to because its two enemies, the US dollar bouncing slightly higher and yields also bouncing higher. So gold wants to watch and see here. If yields and the dollar resume the rally, then gold will reverse. Investing in gold right now is extremely risky. It wasn't always the case, but it is, at least for now. What about Bitcoin? What's going on here? Not looking good. The bullish trend still intact, but it is starting to look bad. You gotta have a little mini alarm signal going on right now if you are a crypto maniac, because we do have a negative divergence in the RSI. And as you saw with the IWM, it's ironic that this chart is eerily similar to the Russell 2000, the RUT. But as you saw in the RUT, the negative divergence and now reversing the trend, and perhaps the bear flag will play out in the RUT, and that will come hand in hand with declines in Bitcoin. Is there any other analyst in YouTube or otherwise talking about the correlation between Bitcoin and the Russell 2000? Not many. What about yields? Yields bouncing higher, but we are still in the series of higher highs and higher lows, so the expectations are the yields will continue to go higher. What about the TLT bond prices? We discussed the bullish scenario yesterday of an ABC pattern leading us to 139. Still intact, but if we dive lower in the red Fibonacci zone, that ABC pattern will go out of the window and we will see lower prices for the TLT and yields will rise higher. What about the VIX? This is the most interesting chart right now in the market. We talked about the MACD indicator. When you're about to make a crossing and suddenly you change your mind and you reverse lower to the opposite direction, in this case lower, it is an ominous bearish signal, meaning that the VIX will go down even more. The problem is, and this is where my skepticism is, yes, the SPY is making a bull flag consolidation that is supposed to go higher. The VIX is looking bearish. So we have two signs so far suggesting that the breakout, the big move that's about to happen, will happen to the upside in the stock market. And here is the third confirmation that the break will happen to the upside. The VIXM, which is the long-term VIX, breaking out of the wedge consolidation to the downside, expecting volatility to subside in the medium term. So we have three factors right now suggesting that the big move will come to the upside. But my skepticism is due to the low volume in the stock market, the lack of conviction in the recent moves higher. That is the one factor that is supporting that the next breakout, the next big move will happen to the downside. For now, the bulls have the advantage, at least from the technical information we have right now. What about Apple? We talked about retesting 125. Today, we went all the way down to 125.15, and then we bounced higher, closing at the highs of the day. That is satisfactory. I'm not going to make a big deal about 15 cents. It went down to 125, confirmed the support, and bounced higher. For now, that is bullish for Apple. And you are seeing the divorce between big cap technology stocks going higher, and that is lifting the NASDAQ, the Qs. Meanwhile, the pain in the mania names continues to go on. The Palantirs of the world, NIO, Plug Power, Blink Charging, all suffering severe losses. So the correction is still going on in the market underneath the facade of the Dow, NASDAQ, and the S&P 500 closing in the green pretty much every single day. What about the souffle Fibonacci perspective? Once again, we talked about the NASDAQ rallying higher. Names like Apple, Microsoft, Facebook, Google, no problems whatsoever. There's a problem in Apple, but not in Google, not in Microsoft, not in Facebook. But take a look at our mania name, an insanity name like the souffle, not participating by much with the recent moves higher in the NASDAQ. And now we are looking for 679. Today we closed below 679. If we close the week below 679, that will be a problem. We are looking for the souffle to go down all the way to the gap pointed on the chart. If it bounces higher, then that will create a higher low, another part of the pattern, and that will be bullish. But if you reach the gap and you continue to dive lower, closing the day below the gap, that will be an ominous reversal signal. So we are watching this gap carefully. And before I wrap up the charts analysis, let's do this. Here is the chart of the souffle, daily chart, the biggest bubble in human history. Take a look at the chart carefully. And now look at this, the psychological pitfalls of a market cycle. We had the euphoria, now we are in the overconfidence. The herd continues to increase their position despite high valuations. Are you taking notes, Mrs. Cathie Wood? And that is followed by an anxiety as the stock starts to crash. Just a little something for the culties to think about. Moving on to the conclusion of this video, what do we have on the economic calendar tomorrow? The initial jobless claims, the weekly jobless claims, per usual. And we also have the wall of worry. Let's review that before we wrap it up. Inflation. Are we worried about inflation? Yes, we are. Still, every piece of data we get is supporting higher inflation. But so long as yields are stabilizing for now, the market is shaking it off. What about tightening monetary policy? The market is thinking about this one, but it is coming in the longer term. So for now, we're shaking it off. What about higher taxes? Today, there was a lot of talk about higher taxes. Janet Yellen talked about it. Biden talked about it. Different governors around the country talked about it. And now it is becoming a reality, accepted even by Wall Street. Jeff Bezos, JP Morgan, they're now endorsing higher taxes. So that is coming, and the market is not going to like it. What about COVID? Are we worried about COVID anymore? Shake it off. What about China? I knew you were troubled, but also shaking it off for now. So absent of yields exploding higher again, the market likes this current environment, specifically with low volume, because the low volume is making the path of least resistance to the upside. That doesn't mean that a lot of us are not suspicious and paying attention. Just take a look at the trade that took place in the options market today regarding the SPY. Somebody very professional, very sophisticated, is hedging for a downward move in the SPY. All we know that there is a massive move coming very soon in the stock market. For now, based on the information we presented in this video, it is tilting toward higher, toward the bull side, because the technicals are very supportive. But if that changes, watch the IWM. That's the canary in the coal mine. Watch the IWM. This is the one that will tell us in which direction the next breakout will be. At least, this is how I see things for now. And remember, these are only my views and opinions. You're allowed to have yours. Okay? Can we shake hands? Can I log off now? Because that's all I got for you tonight, and I will talk to you again tomorrow. If you found the information presented in this video helpful, please subscribe, press the like button, the notification button, follow me on social media.